If you want to see how I reduced my belly fat from this to this, then stay tuned. By the end of this video, you will know about my tips on how I reduced my belly fat as an endomorph. For more lifestyle and health videos, don't forget to like this video and also please subscribe to my channel. And please hit that bell notification so that you're notified when I upload twice a week, every week. I lost a good amount of belly fat, even up to 2.5 inches off of my waist, following these tips that I will share with you in this video. Throughout the video, each tip gets more and more relevant, so make sure that you keep watching. Now, since I am an endomorph, I hold onto fat pretty easily. I try to follow these tips pretty well in my daily life. As an endomorph, you have a little less room to make mistakes compared to ectomorphs and mesomorphs. Endomorphs hold on to more body fat, so I know that kind of sucks. But here is what I do to try and reduce my belly fat. Now, the first thing that I had to understand that you do not need to do specific ab exercises to get rid of the belly fat. Doing these will help tone and define your abs, but if there is fat on top of the abs, these exercises will not help with the overlaying fat. The main thing is to focus on your diet. In order to reduce the amount of belly fat as an endomorph that I have, I try really hard to reduce the amount of refined processed carbohydrates in my diet. Refined processed carbs are carbohydrates that have flour or enriched or grain without the word whole in front of the word. This means that not all of the grain is there, and so some nutrients are missing. This might be the case in some breads, such as multigrain, mixed grain, things like that. So definitely watch out for those on the ingredient label. When you are eating a refined processed grain, you're eating a grain without the protein and without the fiber attached to it. With no fiber and no protein to slow down the digestion and the absorption of that carbohydrate, your body will quickly release more insulin than would otherwise be the case if your carbohydrate had been a whole carbohydrate or a non-refined, non-processed carbohydrate. Now, refined processed carbohydrates create huge insulin spikes in your body. And as we know, insulin is a huge culprit of belly fat. The more insulin that is introduced into your body, the more your belly fat is increased. Of course, whole grains and even like whole carbohydrates will cause insulin spikes to occur, but it will be much less than would be the case with a refined processed carbohydrate. And that is because the fiber and protein make that response much less. And as a bonus, whole grains can help you lose weight, because if you're eating whole grains or unrefined, unprocessed carbohydrates, these can make you feel more full because of the added fiber and the protein in this carbohydrate. Since they are absorbed and digested much more slowly, your feeling of satiety is felt for much longer. Whereas, again, refined processed carbohydrates make you feel hungrier more quickly and will make you crave even more simple sugars. Obviously, simple sugars such as cake, cookies, chips, soda, these can make you gain weight and cause high insulin spikes. And this therefore increases your belly fat. The second thing is I reduced the amount of dairy in my diet. I've replaced my Greek yogurt with cashew yogurt, but I still do eat eggs and even some milk sometimes. But when I can, I do try to avoid milk products, mainly cream, milk, those types of things I like to replace with non-dairy alternatives. For example, if I am getting a Starbucks drink, I like to substitute the cream with either oat milk or almond milk, even though it costs extra, I know. This is also because I feel very heavy and I feel very almost nauseous when I eat milk-based products. So an interesting fact for you is that 75% of the world's population is actually cannot digest lactose. They cannot break down lactose, which is a main sugar ingredient that is in milk, regular cow's milk. Lactose intolerance is especially high in East Asian people, affecting about 70 to 100% of their population. For example, me. And so this lactose intolerance can cause gas, bloating, cramping, diarrhea. These symptoms can exacerbate a big belly and make it look like you have more belly fat if your belly is distended or bloated because of dairy. Also, the uncomfortable feeling of eating dairy if you're lactose intolerant is just not a pleasant experience. The third thing I did was to reduce the amount of sodium overall in my diet. This again helps with bloating, which can help the overall appearance and flatness of your tummy. Processed foods have a lot of salt, so staying away from processed foods will help with the bloating, will help to decrease the amount of sodium in your diet, and then also decrease the amount of bloating in your belly. Some tips I have for decreasing the amount of sodium in your diet include if your recipe calls for 2 teaspoons of table salt, then try to reduce it to just half, maybe 1 teaspoon of table salt. And then slowly your taste buds will accumulate and become more sensitive to salt as you progress. And then eventually you will be able to eat almost no salt. Or if you go out to eat somewhere, your saltiness level will be totally altered and everything you eat will become extremely salty. So that's a good thing. That's good for your blood pressure. That's good for your heart. So I would recommend that you do that tip. And in some Asian recipes, it calls for 2 tablespoons of soy sauce. I will try to reduce that to 1 tablespoon of soy sauce so that I am at least trying to lower my sodium in some way. And this can help decrease the overall sodium in your diet. The fourth thing is to increase the amount of protein in my diet. Eating plenty of protein can boost your metabolism and reduce your hunger levels. Some studies suggest that protein is particularly effective against abdominal fat. Just how I was talking about earlier, complex carbohydrates can take a long time to digest. Proteins take even longer to digest. So because of that, you will feel full for much longer, which is ideal for weight loss and belly fat loss. Examples of animal types of protein that I like to eat is chicken, beef, fish, and eggs. Now, of course, if you're a vegetarian or if you're vegan, there are really good protein alternatives. Even you guys, as vegetarians and vegans, can have high protein diets as well. And this would be with tofu, edamame, lentils, chickpeas, beans, and some more surprising foods would include oats, Ezekiel bread, soy milk, wild rice, and quinoa. So there really is an option for everyone to increase the protein in their diet. Now, the fifth thing is that I will really try to focus on controlling my cortisol levels. And this can help to reduce your belly fat. Cortisol is a hormone that can be elevated when you are stressed out. Prolonged stress with higher levels of cortisol encourage your body to hold on to more fat and slow your metabolism. Higher long-term cortisol levels have been shown to be linked to abdominal obesity. I've shown in my previous video how I use self-care in order to decrease my cortisol levels in my daily life. If you want to watch that video, check it out in the cards. The way that you can decrease your cortisol levels in your body will all depend up to you on what is best for you. It depends on your own psychological stress and how you can best deal with it. Now for me, that includes taking the time out to learn a new dance on YouTube or taking dance classes or journaling my thoughts out, because I love to dance and I love to release my emotions through paper. Some examples for you could be reading a really nice book if you enjoy reading, doing a spa day with a face mask, whatever you enjoy doing, literally. Meditation is also a good one. There are some apps called Calm or Headspace. A lot of people have recommended those apps, and I've used Calm before, and it is a good app. These apps kind of give you guided meditation. So if this can help you decrease your cortisol levels, then I would recommend it. Now, socializing and spending time with friends can obviously decrease your cortisol levels as well and make you less stressed out, but it's harder in this day and age. So even setting up FaceTime calls or video chats with your friends and your family would be an ideal situation. Now, I know everyone knows this and nobody wants to hear it, but stress can also be reduced by exercising. High intensity interval training is good and can burn a lot of calories, but doing it every single day for multiple days in a row with no rest day at all can cause your cortisol levels to actually increase. So you are already stressed outside of your exercise, but going into your exercise, you are stressed again. So this can actually increase your cortisol levels. So pairing high intensity interval training with low intensity cardio or low intensity training such as cycling or yoga, or just taking a brisk walk outside, or even walking on the treadmill on an incline. These are all low intensity exercises that can decrease your cortisol. Now, of course, I will still eat chips here and there. I will still eat Starbucks drink with milk, or sometimes you have to go to McDonald's and get a coffee and they don't have oat milk or almond milk. So obviously I have a lot of exceptions to these rules as well. I definitely don't live a perfect lifestyle food choices wise. I do like to eat what I want when I want to eat it. So I will still eat chips and I will still eat dairy and ice cream and simple sugars, but the real key here is moderation. I am obviously still working on that myself, but understanding what is sustainable for you and what is sustainable for me is very important. Because taking these things and bringing them into your life for a long-term period of time and not having it be a one-and-done situation, such as just doing it for 2 weeks and then going crazy after 2 weeks because you restricted yourself. So I really think that moderation is key, and learning how these tips can be sustainable and incorporated into your lifestyle is very important. Following these tips strictly isn't necessary, but will probably be very helpful if you are an endomorph especially. So if you guys like this video, please hit that like button and don't forget to subscribe to my channel. I hope you guys have a good week and I hope you guys are staying safe. Okay, bye.